sir. How are you? What's up?
Hi,
John.
How are you?
Pleasure to meet you.
Maxie?
How are you?
Oh, man.
You can
stay right here.
All right. Sherrod, you're good there?
Yep.
Just stay on the mic, stay as close as I can. This might work better. Just get in there. Didn't do it either. All right.
First of all, thank you, everyone, for coming. And before we start, it's my lovely wife's birthday tomorrow, and she loves surprises.
Oh.
It's not a party. It's just cupcakes for everyone.
Oh, happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear.
There we go.
Happy birthday to you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Adam, for venturing all the way up to the Upper West Side.
Oh, you're welcome.
And Sherrod Small.
Thank you.
Well, you're here like every day.
Yeah, but I have to come from the Upper East Side.
But when was the last time you were on the West Side? Probably don't venture up here often.
A couple days ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Wait, where do you live?
I live in the Village.
I live right
in the Village. Yeah, okay. Right by Astor Place.
But you guys know each other.
Yes.
You guys have met before.
We met through Jeff Frost.
Jeff Frost, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he brings people together.
Okay, he is. He's like a binding force in the universe.
Yes.
You wouldn't think it, but
you just met him from the downtown scene.
Jeff and I met years ago. He had done a movie called Patriot Act, and I think I met him through Saget. And I went to see. He asked me to come see Patriot Act at a first screening of it, like they had at the comedy festival years ago, and it was really good. And then we showed it at my house. We had a movie night at my house, and we showed Patriot Act there. And he and I became really good friends. This is, I don't know how long ago. We did a USO tour together.
Nice.
It was like me, Colin Kane, Sarah Tiana, Jeff, Stewie Stone as the MC, and Robert Klein.
Wow.
So it was like five funny people and me, who can only play the most miserable songs we have. That's the only ones I can still play on piano because I don't remember how the rest of them go. But
movie night?
What'd you say?
How often do you do movie night?
We used to do it every week.
There hasn't
been as much lately.
Was that tour in the Middle East?
No, this one was...
it was in the States.
The hospitals. No, it went to Germany.
Oh, okay.
Like Rammstein and the hospitals around there. It was for a lot of people that were, when they get injured, that's where they fly everyone to. So it was for a lot of sort of disabled veterans and people who are really going through some rehab.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. But it was fun. It was like a weird camp for a few days. I did a movie with the Broken Lizard guys, and it was a lot like that, just spending 2 months or 3 months with those guys, spending a week with the guys over in Germany. It was just like going to camp with funny,
Yeah, was there a difference between hanging out with comics on that tour and musicians?
Less drugs.
Less drugs with the musicians, yeah.
No, less drugs with the comics. You know y'all always holding.
Come on, I don't know a comic who's not stoned.
Oh, yeah, we stay stoned. You're right.
Pretty much. It's like a constant thing.
Y'all got hotter groupies, though, too. Let's keep that real.
That's also true, yeah.
Yeah, very true. it's been
a good life.
And you grew up where?
Well, all over. Born on the East Coast, then Texas, and then Northern California, like San Francisco, Berkeley, Oakland. I grew up in Oakland and Berkeley.
How much time you spent in Texas?
About 5 years when I was young.
Was that like a weird transition from the East for a Jewish kid?
Well, it was weird because I'd been born in Baltimore, and then we moved to Boston when I was about three for my dad to go for his internships because he was in medical school. And that's going from one of the worst accents in the world to another, let's say, fairly strong accent from Baltimore to Boston.
Yeah.
And I was speaking pretty early, so I was desperate not to sound like I was from Baltimore. So I worked myself into a kind of Kennedy Fuhrer very quickly. And then we moved right down to Texas. My dad had gotten in the Army during Vietnam, and he was stationed in El Paso. And it was an even faster shift down there just to avoid getting the shit kicked out of me.
Are you an only child?
No, my little sister, but she was really young.
Right.
So then we were in Texas for about 4 or 5 years.
They used to be jazzed down there?
What'd you say?
Did you get chased around down there when you first moved in?
It was just a little weird at first because I sounded pretty weird.
Right.
You know, but... I think I liked it a lot. You know, it's the first place I remember. You know, when you're a kid, there's those years where you don't do things unless you're with your parents.
Yeah.
And then at a certain age, you go wander off and do shit. And
right.
I got to Texas for first grade, and it was that time, like the first time I remember being off on my own. It's, you know, El Paso's just desert, you know, it's, you know, a lot of spiders and snakes and shit like that. It's the first time I remember reading on my own.
Right.
And so I really loved it. I loved El Paso. I didn't like Houston so much when we got there.
Okay, what was wrong? What was Houston? What was the difference?
That's the worst of Texas. It's just big belt, big hat, big car, big steak, big, and it's all in the city.
And how old were you when you moved to Berkeley?
10.
10 years old.
Like that, yeah, I think.
Okay. That's when you started playing music?
No, that's when I moved to, we moved to Oakland when I was 10. I started playing music, I started kind of late. I mean, I was in some bands when I was about 12 or 13. But they're just, you know, they're just cover bands. I didn't write my first song, I think, until freshman fall term of college.
You played an instrument when you were 12?
Shitty. I played bass in my first band, which is a mystery to me today because I have no idea how to play bass. And I can't believe I ever did, but I know I did. I played bass and I sang. But we're just doing, like, you know, our parents would buy each of us. They offered to buy, like, a songbook for each of us. So we just picked the biggest ones. We got the Beatles, the Stones, and Zeppelin because they're... Mm-hmm. A lot of songs. Yeah, you got more bang for your buck on those. So that's all we did, really.
And you covered all those songs.
We would play them. You know, we play at friends' bar mitzvahs and stuff.
And this was all in the Bay Area?
That's in the Bay Area.
What do your parents think?
What did they think of
when
that?
When you first started playing music?
Not no son of mine.
Shits playing. They're both doctors. They were in it. You know, they're like both doctors, sort of Jewish intellectual types. They thought that was cool.
Okay. Yeah.
But we were probably fucking adorable in a really shitty way that you don't want to be. 13 years old playing at people's bar mitzvahs at some break in the middle.
How connected were you to Judaism? Most of us are probably super Jewish in here.
Yeah, I'm a black belt Jew.
They have mezuzahs really on the door here.
I was brought up, you know, in a fairly intense reform to conservative Judaism, but... I kind of got apostate. I went over there when I was, I went to Israel when I was 16, and then I went back again when I was 18.
You're on a birthright.
What'd you say?
That's a Sherrod joke.
Yeah, the birthright.
You know what birthright is.
I just like how you said, I went over there, like you're talking about the war and shit.
No, you don't know, you know what birthright is?
Yeah, when you got to go back to Israel.
No, it's an organization, they send kids that have never been to Israel.
Oh, really?
Like for free.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think this was that, I don't know.
No.
But, you know, we all went over there, worked on a kibbutz for a little while when I was 16. Mostly just got high, drank a lot, because there's no law there for that. I mean, it seemed, for a kid, there's only one law that matters. That's you can't drink, you can't smoke, you can't go out.
Right.
So there's no law. Mm-hmm. You climb out the window and go get high.
Did you realize how much hotter the Jews were there than here?
I don't remember. Well, we're over there with all these kids from here, and you know.
It's all beachfront over there, though,
yeah,
baby.
Yeah, yeah. Everybody, I got heat stroke.
Did you?
Oh, yeah, man. Like in Haifa, I remember getting heat stroke. That night we went to see a screening of Rocky Horror Picture Show at a midnight showing in Haifa. And so there's like four different languages going on the screen, you know, the subtitles. And I started to hallucinate. And it was very, very, very unpleasant. There's the movie. There's the people on stage faking it, dancing, singing. There's four languages. I started to hallucinate with those. It was not a good night, actually.
They were live performing the movie?
Yeah, if you go to see Rocky, at least they used to. They'd all get up on stage and act it out, I guess. I remember doing it in Berkeley and not hallucinating, and it was more fun. the other types of hallucination are far, far superior as an enjoyment spectacle than sunstroke, which is fairly low on the fun scale.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
Yeah. You've been to Israel?
Never been to Israel. Want to go, though. Do want to go, you know, Haifa, Tel Aviv.
It was a cool, especially the first time I went, they still had Sinai, so we went all through Sinai.
Mm-hmm.
Second time I went, we stole a Jeep and got drunk and tried to drive south from Eilat and ran straight into a border, which was not good.
What?
The wrong border.
Well, there was a border there now. There hadn't been. 2 years before, Sinai had been a part of Israel. While I was gone, they gave it back to Egypt, and then we just got drunk and took some Garren. Got in a lot of trouble. And that wasn't as cool.
How old were you then?
17.
Okay, you're
maybe
supposed to do
18.
Stuff like that.
Yeah.
Now, did you get influenced by music when you heard it over there? That?
Not really.
No?
I mean, it's just they were playing our music over there then.
Right.
You don't hear a lot of...
There were Israeli bands later that I checked out. Like, what's that band called? It was really good. No, there was like a guitar pop band, like a teenage fan clubish band.
You don't hear of a lot of Israeli bands these days. You're big into just finding new artists. Have you seen anyone from Israel that you like recently?
No. I mean, the guy who does all the the filming for us is Israeli, our videographer.
Okay.
I met him like, I don't know how long ago. He was like a fan kid coming to shows like 20 years ago. Mm. Now he's all grown up.
Mm-hmm. Where do you discover, because you have a music festival.
Yeah.
Right, Underwater Sunshine.
Sunshine, yeah.
So how do you discover new
What's
artists?
The name of it?
Underwater Sunshine.
Okay, good. I like it.
I'm just looking.
You definitely
around.
Smoke pot in your life.
There was a time. You know. I wish I still could. It's the only thing I miss from the drugs is the pot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just like look for it all the time. I'm always just wandering through things trying to find music.
Mm-hmm. And Underwater Sunshine is a music festival that...
Well, it was the name of a record we made where it was a cover album, but we mostly covered... The smart way to do a cover album is to cover all these famous songs, and then everybody just wants it. We did the most obscure cover album ever made. There's like indie bands of our friends, just nothing on there anyone knew. I really loved the record, but... And it was called Underwater Sunshine. And then... my friend and I started a podcast, and we decided to use that name.
Okay.
And when we restarted the festival to do it after the Outlaw Roadshow, everyone in the festival came to me and said, hey, we like the name Underwater Sunshine. Can we just call it that, too?
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed like, well, we've got a branding thing. Why not?
So how many – you've done this for a few years, the festival?
This is our second festival.
And know? Where is it?
It's in down at Bowery Electric right now. It's okay, small, nice. In the village. Yeah. But we did Outlaw Roadshow for about 7 or 8 years, and here, Austin – Nashville, Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
Most of us worked on that before this. So we did that all over.
How many bands in the festival?
Well, last time what we do is we have these night shows on Friday and Saturday at the club, but then we film acoustic sets by all the bands all day long for 4 days, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Damn. So we had 18 bands play mm-hmm. the festival, and we filmed 38.
Wow.
Acoustic sets.
Do you handpick the bands?
Well, all of us do together. I picked a bunch of them.
Okay.
There's about 7 of us who work on it, and we all picked them.
And it's next month, right?
Yeah, it's April 5th and 6th.
Okay. All at the Bowery Electric.
Yeah, except the acoustic stuff. Okay. Yeah.
Now, what's the music scene? What do you see like in New York City? Do you see like not enough places to play anymore? I see like Continental closed down, and CBGB's been closed for a while, but it's...
Yeah, there's still a lot of clubs. There generally are. I mean, it's harder in a city like... San Francisco, where you know, this has been a big city and a really successful city for a very, very, very long time. So there's always areas that are up, that are down. You can find a place to put a club. It's harder in a place like San Francisco where something comes along like the .com that blows it up through the roof, and all of a sudden all those warehouses, garages, everything becomes condos.
Right.
And now those are the places where, forget playing, bands rehearsed it. Mm-hmm. If you can't rehearse, you can't play, you know? I mean, that kind of happened after we left out there.
Right.
You know that, but here there still seems to be, I mean, I remember a lot of clubs that aren't here anymore too, but I think that just happens. Tramps is gone, Brownies, those Tramps are all cool when I was younger.
Yeah.
But there still seems to be a lot, and there's always new ones opening. I went to see this band, Sunflower Bean, at Warsaw a few months ago. I'd never been there before. That place was pretty mm-hmm. cool.
Nice.
You know, it's kind of like Bowery Ballroom or... It's like a bit, and there's that place, Brooklyn Steel. I saw a Dashboard Confessional there. Mm-hmm. There seems to be a lot. Those are both in Brooklyn, which is, that's one thing. That's a new place for, you know, in the last like 10 or 15 years for a lot of clubs. And there's still, Alphabet City has a ton of stuff. And there's things.
Which are the best cities, which cities have the best venues for music?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose it changes to play in. Well, my favorite venue is probably the Greek Theater in Berkeley. That's the best place I've ever seen a show. It's the best place I've ever played a show.
What do you like so much about it?
It's just great. It's an open-air amphitheater, but it's not like the other ones. It's actually built like a Roman amphitheater, so it's stone steps going up. It's really beautiful. The sound is impeccable.
Really?
I mean, it was my favorite place to see shows when I was a kid. And it's my favorite place to play now. We don't get to play there very often, though. It's a little smaller than the other places out there because it's probably 9,000, and there are places that are 15 to 20, so...
Mm-hmm.
We don't get to play there very often.
Damn. 9,000? That still sounds like a lot to me.
What's the worst? I don't even have to say it, but what's the worst venue? Or describe a bad venue.
Well, it just depends on what's going on there that day. You know, it could be... I mean, we played a place in Knoxville, Tennessee once when we were opening for Cracker, and there's no... the backstage was at the back of the hall, not the back where the stage is, but the other end of it.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way to get up on the stage was... They kind of kept a walkway around the fringes of the crowd, so you had to walk all the way around you know, three sides of the place, and then you'd walk up the stairs, and the stage was like across a triangle, like across a corner. And we were opening, it was in the first 3 or 4 months of our first album tour, and the horns were all blown in the monitors, like the treble part. So it's just like they're just going, and there's low end, but no mid or high. It's, all the horns are blown. So it's just, hell, it was the worst sound ever. I couldn't hear anything I was doing. We were terrible, and I was really frustrated. And when we were done, it was just quiet.
What, the audience?
I mean, it was just quiet. Nobody did anything. Nobody clapped. It was just like, there, you don't get to just go off the back. You have to kind of walk down off the stage.
Back around the crowd.
Walk all the way around three sides of the crowd and then go into the room. That's what I remember is the worst show ever because, mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't remember ever not getting any applause except that one time where it was just kind of uncomfortable and quiet. I felt bad for them. Because they had to be really, if as uncomfortable as I was, I felt like they were probably pretty uncomfortable too. On the other hand, fuck them. Yeah. It's really the fault of the club, though. That, you know.
What size room is your favorite?
Oh, big. I like playing big places. I like playing festivals.
Yeah.
Just because we like to do a lot of intimate things. You know, we like to improvise whole sections, make up songs, inside songs. And it's cool to play that in a club. You get the response every time. Mm-hmm. But if you can do it with 60,000 people at a festival in Europe where they don't know you that well, if you can, like... Because when we first went over to Europe to play festivals, we were getting all this advice about, don't do that stuff, don't stretch the songs out, just play the way they're supposed to be, because these people don't know you. But I lost focus and did it anyways. And
right.
Like, if you can pull that off for the crowd that doesn't know you, you know, or just a big crowd. If you can get a crowd to go pin drop quiet for something, I feel that's really cool.
I read that you play the songs that you want to play, and you play it how you want to play it, not based on what the audience wants to hear, right?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
You asshole. Yeah.
I suppose there's a...
They're like, we didn't come for this. Fuck off.
Yeah, well, it's more than my crew gets that, because I'm gone before they realize it. Like, they're still thinking it's coming, and we're not there anymore. But I've had mostly the same crew for 25 years. A lot of them have been there so this the whole time. And so they'll tell me later when, you know, like, fuck you. Like, the next day, you're like, by the way, I caught a lot of shit for that. What do you mean you got? Well, I'm on stage, I'm cleaning things up, and they're just like, people are furious. I think with us, you kind of know what you're in for, so either you're there for that, or either you love us because we're improvisational, or you don't because we're fucking up the songs you like the way that you want to hear them. I don't know. I don't want to be... I get why people like that, too, because, you know, it's... You associate it with a certain point in your life where you listened to something and loved it, and you want to recreate that moment when you go to see a band play. Mm-hmm. But the band... coincidentally, is not dead.
Yeah.
So they're still living their life in the present, not necessarily 20 years ago, and they want to still create and do stuff. And you know, there's a certain it's a tension though. I get it. You know, I just, you know, I don't want to completely give in to that because I, you know, I got stuff I want to do.
So right. I mean, you've been obviously super successful, but
we've been successful.
No, but what have you? What, super. What do you
Super's
feel?
Different.
What do you feel like you've failed at that most super. People. I mean,
I feel
it was
like we failed at super.
What, being super?
Yeah, like I feel like we failed at super in some ways. I think there was a lot of things we did that were important to me and that seemed like really good things. And at a time when I didn't really know what I was doing, I made decisions based on what felt right to me. Because the biggest fear I had when we started out was doing things I didn't want to do and regretting them later.
Right.
I felt like I'd never be able to put that back. And so I did a lot of stuff the way I wanted to do it. Not out of arrogance, it just seemed like the right thing to do. But, you know, I could, with perspective later, I could see some of them were mistakes, you know. And they may have held us back from being super successful.
Give me an example.
Well, we made our first album. It sold, you know, I don't know, 10, 15 million records, whatever.
Yeah. Let me borrow some money.
Yeah. It's all gone, man.
Damn it.
Gone. It's all gone. I spent it all on, well, first pot, then cupcakes.
Okay. Priorities.
We you know, like people wanted us to do it again. You want us to work with T-Bone Burnett again and make the same record again, make August and Everything After, or After August and Everything After, whatever you want to call it. And we didn't want to. We weren't interested. We had other things we wanted to do. We caught a lot of shit from the record company for, we got the guy that produced all the Pixies records because I wanted to work with Gil Norton. That's a number one record, but the next record we chose to go find the guys who'd done Sparkle Horse records, you know, because that was the stuff we were interested in and we wanted to chase it towards musical things that satisfied us. And I have no regrets about anything on the records. That's one place I don't have any regrets. Like, I feel like we're 8-0 or 7-0, whatever it is, on the records. But, you know, there were ways to do it that probably would have made us bigger. But I don't know if they would have made us happier or not. But,
right.
You know, like, so we were a huge band at one point, and we never got to be a stadium band or even an arena band. Like, we're not at the level of playing the gardens all over America. Right. You know, we're doing okay in
unless you announce that you're breaking up, then you'll sell out the garden.
I think I'd have to announce that I shot myself.
You need
or
video in this day and age.
On night, on stage every night. For one tour, every night, Adam Duritz will shoot himself in the mouth and shut up.
Gotta see that show.
Yeah, see that. That'll draw a crowd.
How do you measure success? Like with your projects, with your albums, with your festival?
Well, like right now I've got three things going on named Underwater Sunshine, none of which have made a penny.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, a record, a podcast, and a festival, which is a free festival. But I really love all three of those things.
That's what matters.
So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I can define success in some ways. It would be nice to be a stadium band, you know, because if we were a stadium band, my crew stuck with me for pretty much most of our, not just the band, but the crew, you know. They'd all have pensions, you know. We could afford that, and we would do whatever we could. You know, everyone would be taken care of. You know, that's not as easy. And with seven guys in the band, many of which have a breeding habit like you would not believe, they have bills, more than I have. They have bills, those guys. Some of them, it's just like, marry, fuck, breed, divorce, marry, fuck, breed.
Divorce, marry, it's like, fuck, breed.
They have not mastered the concept of subdivision. You know? But, you know, like, that would be great to have a more of a financial success that way because, you know, then we'd all be comfortable for life. We wouldn't have to worry about any of this shit. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's not. It's harder for them. You know, I'm okay, but it's harder for those guys. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I think you got to kind of measure it by what works for you, you know, because the truth is there's no way to plan for having a hit record. You don't know how to make it happen, and you don't know what to do with it once it does happen. Mm-hmm. It's all pretty different, you know. And you're fooling yourself if you think you can. So I'm not sure what else you can do differently. And, you know, you think you're just going to do good. I mean, all you did on your first album for us is you did what you wanted to do. It turned out really well, right. And everybody liked it. All we did on our second album was do what we wanted to do. It turned out really well. I like it.
Right.
You know, and a lot of people liked it, but not as many as the first one. And that's kind of been the same pattern for every record. You know, we did what we wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I'm really proud of it. It came out great. I love it.
Yeah.
But not everybody does, you know, and there's just no way to plan for that. So why do a bunch of things that someone else tells you they know will be the you know, the recipe for success? Because they don't know shit.
They don't know. They're guessing. Yeah. You'd rather fail with your own shit or get what you get with your own shit than chasing somebody else's dumb plans.
Yeah, because all they really know is what worked last time.
Yeah.
Which wasn't even necessarily their idea. They just saw it happen, and, you know, that's safer for their job. You know, record companies are kind of the bane of all of our existence.
Besides the podcast, the festival, and an album, is there something else you're excited for in the future?
Say world peace, you asshole.
Well,
is everything music for you?
That seems unlikely. World peace, of ass. I don't know. I worked on a play for a while with a friend. My friend Stephen Belber and I were working on a play, and we got invited out to Ojai Playwright Conference, and we did it out there, and it was pretty well received. And then we've just been too busy to finish it since then. I'm always leaving on tour or making a record, and he's going off to direct a movie or work on a play. And, you know, we had dinner the other night. I hadn't seen him in a couple years, and we were both talking about how much we'd like to get back to that because we really liked it.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be nice to do, like something to do later on in life that doesn't involve touring as much, you know. Although the truth is I love touring now. I used to really have trouble being on the road all that time. But now it's a little weirder being at home.
Yeah.
Well, it's just you spend every night in hotel rooms. You know, it's all, you don't know anybody. You get pretty isolated.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel like you've grown accustomed to that now?
Yeah, I do.
So when you're home, you feel like, what the hell is this place?
Well, I think I've done better on it recently, but, you know, for the while, the last 4 or 5 years, I think I had more of a struggle at home because it was just less familiar. For the last 25 years, I've spent most of my time with this group of about, let's say, 15 to 20 guys mm-hmm. and girls, you know, men and women in my crew and my band.
Right.
I spent a lot of my life with those people, more of my life than the other portion of it. I probably spent more time with these people than anyone. You know, it's getting to a point where maybe even more than my parents, you know. So I've grown used to the schedule of it, to the knowing where to be and where you're supposed to be. It can be a little more amorphous and hard at home. I don't know what the fuck to do with myself sometimes. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have work to do, but it's got to be all self-motivated.
That's why you have a podcast.
Right? Yeah, and that's one thing. It is nice about that because I work on it every day.
Yeah.
You know, I'll spend hours and hours listening to music, researching stuff online, you know, putting together notes, trying to design shows about this or that, some of which I know some about and don't know a lot about. You know, I spend a lot of time working on the podcast.
You can really tell how much you love it. I've seen your videos on Instagram about the podcast, yeah. And you're much different in your videos, and it shows how comfortable you are than, like, an interview.
I had a good one this morning, and my girlfriend was still asleep, so I couldn't get her okay on it. But I realized while I was lying in bed that from a certain angle, this is how you could tell I had sort of food poisoning this morning. From a certain angle, your elbow looks a lot like someone's ass.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so I got the phone on my elbow, and I took a whole picture and talked about the podcast we released today, and it really looked like you were looking at my ass. And then right at the end, I panned down, thumbs up. You know. But
how often do you release a podcast?
Every week. Okay. Every Wednesday now. We did a lot. Like the first year we did it, we didn't start till about the third or fourth week of January, and we did 48 podcasts in the first year, which is 46. Maybe 46.
Yeah.
Which is pretty good. I mean,
that's like once a goddamn week, right?
Yeah. And I was gone. Yeah. For 3.5 months on tour, mm-hmm. So
were you doing it out there on a tour as well?
No, we built up a backlog and we miscounted. We thought we had enough to get through all the tour, and we ended up falling too short, so we kind of screwed that up. But
did you have to do a best of?
No, we just didn't release it that week.
And everybody went apeshit? I know the fans go.
I don't think there's
every time
people
we miss a week,
it was
a day late for the podcast.
How many episodes are you in? You've been doing
like
this for 6 or 7 years.
Yeah, we've been doing like 5-6 years for every day, every week.
This was 55 today for us.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's about me also. I started mine a year ago. We're like 55 also.
How long? What's your podcast?
Race Wars.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
So you're like, what, 500 something in?
A lot. Yeah.
Man, about you get a lot of podcasts.
Yeah.
How many do you get in a year? Do you get in like...
We do once a week, so I usually don't miss, even if I have to like double up a week or something like that. But yeah, we usually
do twice a week for Patreon, right?
Well, we split it in half because we do like maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours each episode. So a lot of yapping.
Yeah. I've tried to cut ours down to an hour and a half because my partner who ends to do put it together when he gets home, he's like, hey, can we just cut out these 2 hour ones, 2.5 hour ones? Just let's get them around 90 minutes.
Yeah.
My partner is this guy who, James Campion, he interviewed me a bunch of times. He writes for the Aquarian Weekly that New Jersey paper, mm-hmm. and he'd interviewed me a bunch of times, and after about 4 or 5 years of this, he brought it up one time, hey, you know, there's so much material I can never use in these articles, we should like write a book mm-hmm. together, and I thought about it for a couple years, and I said okay, and then we got together, and we hung out like once a week for about 5 or 6 hours for about a year. And at the end of that, I called him and said, hey, there's so much we're never going to be able to use in the book. We should do a podcast. And so we started a podcast. That's exactly how it happened. But I don't think there's enough people interested yet for it to be a big uproar. I'm still taking pictures of my arm trying to look mm-hmm. like my ass.
You should do. Have you done any live podcasts?
Any what?
Live podcasts?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
Who did I do? I did Adam Carolla's last year. I can't remember what else I did. I did a couple, but not a lot. I've got a couple friends who do them. Do you know Brian Callen?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Brian's got one. He said I could come on his.
Okay. No, yeah. But have you done come on Race Wars. Audience? Your podcast?
Oh, ours? No. We do. What we do is a lot is when we do have the festival and we have the acoustic bands recording at my house. We'll do interviews after all those and put them together with some of their acoustic performances in our interviews.
Oh, that's cool.
That's the most. But I was kind of worried. I didn't know how to interview anyone. So that was a learning curve for me, just not to be stupid on the air. Because it's real easy. The first three or four podcasts we did, there was a lot of stupid. Like, just really boring.
And you left it right in? You left it
in? No, I didn't put them out.
Okay.
It took me about 3 or 4 weeks of podcasts to
Did you listen
okay
to them
one.
After?
Oh, yeah. And they were total pieces of shit. Absolute and complete. Just there's a way you sound where you're like, I think it would be great to sit around and talk about music and geek out or talk about whatever we want to talk about with friends, you know? But it's not that easy to do that because you get in front of a mic and you start thinking about the fact that you're on a mic. And
that's right.
Even at this point in my career, it was easy to suck. And we did for a while. But then we cleaned it up, you know, it got better. And I wasn't looking for it to be perfect, just not a total stinking piece of shit.
Don't get rid of those first three, though. Hold on to them.
We got them there.
Because you can do you can go back on another podcast and say, look how awful we were on the first three.
Do a throwback podcast.
And that'll be your biggest podcast.
Has yours gotten better over time?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. We were just two dudes falling down a flight of stairs.
Which is funny.
Yeah, still got a
long history of that in comedy.
Because, just changing gears for a sec, then if it's okay, you know, we can take some questions from people that are here. Because of your music career, what do you feel like you've missed out on in other areas of your life, whether a family or
something else
that you haven't been able to do?
I missed a lot of stuff.
Tempo.
Yeah, I missed a lot of tempo. But I was gonna miss a lot of tempo. You know, for me with that, you know, I went over, when I was over in Israel the second time, I got really involved in going to see yeshivas over there and studying.
Oh,
I don't remember.
You don't remember
like 1980, 82, you know. And I got really interested because Judaism is a little different than other religions. It's not really faith-based. It's more about like you're not supposed to. Paul would say that the biggest thing for a Christian is a blind faith is the highest kind of faith for a Christian because it just shows you just trust in God or Jesus or whatever. But for a Jew, you're supposed to study and you're supposed to find, you know, rational reasons to support the things, you know. And I got really into that and really interested in it. And then I think Israel's a bad place to do that. I got really freaked out. I started to have this real religious epiphany, but then I kind of flipped on it, and I just sort of realized that, you know, my dad believed this and taught me, and his dad taught him, and his dad taught him, and it's a lot of trust in a line of people that, at a certain level, it is kind of just faith in something, and I wasn't comfortable with that, and also, having been brought up Reformed and then read it a little more carefully, it didn't actually say, here's a bunch of laws, mitzvot, do whatever you're comfortable with, and I'm good with that as long as you have a bagel. It actually says, you know, at the slightest hint of disagreement, I will smite your ass with lightning. You know, and I felt like, well, what have they been telling me all these years about it being okay to just sort of do part of it? And so I went to a couple rabbis I knew over there and asked the question. Some of the people that had, you know, led my trip over 2 years before were there with other kids now. And I said, I'm having trouble with this because the stuff that you've been telling me is okay, you know, the Old Testament doesn't actually say it's okay. It says it's not okay. Mm-hmm. So how come it's okay? And they all kind of told me, you know, hey, don't stress. Don't worry about this. It's not that big a deal. You know, we're Jews. And I got kind of bummed out about that because it didn't make any sense to me. And then when I got home, I felt really guilty every time I was in temple. I felt like I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing. And I got really angry because they're all telling me it's fine. I went to my rabbi when I got home and asked him the same question, and he didn't have any kind of answer. I just felt like when I was in temple, I was lying. And it was a real problem for me. It's maybe I wasn't supposed to question that, but I did, and I had a lot of troubles with it for a few years. And then I finally, it was weird. I went to a friend's wedding, and he had married a Jewish girl whose family was really, he was not. And he converted for her, and he cleaned up what had been a particularly messy, if entertaining, life. And at his wedding, they asked me to chant an Aliyah, and so I did. You know, and I hadn't been in a temple in about 4 or 5 years at that point. And I really loved singing it. I really got a lot of feeling when I sang it. And I thought all that weekend, maybe this is time for me to get back involved in this. And then on the Sunday, or the Saturday night after the wedding, they're having the Havdalah service, you know, the extinguishing the end of the Sabbath. And I loved that song from going to camp, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I sang along with it, and I was feeling really motivated about this whole thing. And then the song ended, except it didn't end. They were still singing. It's just the part that I knew. It's like the Star Spangled Banner. We know the first verse. Right. You know? there are all these. No one could write a one-verse song back then, and so there's all these other verses. It went on and on. And pretty soon, there's just like these four old men. And it's in this temple in Wilkes-Barre. It's a weird town at that point. Like, clearly it was a vital, thriving Jewish community at one point. And now all of the young people have moved away. This incredible edifice of a synagogue. It's incredibly beautiful, but it's kind of run down. You know, this is a culture that's sort of dying out.
Right.
And everyone, there's like 100 people there in this room, is sitting there, and these four old men are still chanting and singing the other 45 verses.
Yes, that nobody else knows.
Yes.
Yeah. They're the four tops of the...
Yeah, and all of a sudden I just thought, it's a disrespectful thought, but I just thought, I'm back to this thing where it's a bunch of old men and we're supposed to trust it, and I just don't see it.
Oh.
And I don't think I'm going to do this anymore. And I didn't. I didn't set foot in a temple from then until like 3 years ago. When my mother decided at her advanced age to get a bat mitzvah.
Oh,
and she
wow.
did it in a group of people. And and she really wanted me to be there. And I was like, I don't really want to go there again. I just really don't, you know. But I went, you know.
Do you have, like, anxiety about just walking in, or?
No, I just, you know, yeah, kind of. I just felt like it caused me a lot of pain when I was younger, and I didn't want to go back to it. It caused me a lot of anger, too. I didn't want to be frustrated, really.
Right.
But I went, and I was proud of my mother. And
how old was she?
She was, she's 78 now, so she was probably 76.
She finally became a woman at 76.
I know. That's what my dad said. I said, well, you were supposed to take care of that in 62. And I'm here. So it was weird. You know, at first, I remembered all the songs and the prayers. I knew them all. And my dad and my sister were, like, kind of shocked that I knew the words to everything. And then I... My mother, you know, you've been to bar mitzvahs, obviously.
Yeah.
We're modern Orthodox.
Right. So
we go to the synagogue every Saturday.
The real joint in a bar mitzvah is the speech that the kid gives, where he proceeds to lecture everyone on Judaism. It's like the graduation speech at a high school graduation.
Their uncle wrote that speech.
Yeah, it's like
4 pages long.
Yeah, it's the rabbi writes it with the kid.
Yeah.
It's a terrible speech because a good rabbi isn't necessarily a good speechwriter.
Right.
But it's always a dumb speech. My mother went first. There was like 8 or 9 women who did this all together.
Oh, okay.
And of different ages, all starting about 30 till my mom and a couple other women who were in their 70s. My mom gave the first speech, and it was really interesting. My mom's really smart. She's a good writer. And she gave this really interesting speech about being a woman in modern America as opposed to when she was growing up. And she was the now meetings used to be at our house in the 70s. Like the liberation movement was a big deal in our family, and the meetings were at our house. And she was talked about that and what it meant to her to finally be able to like have her bat mitzvah at this point in her life. Of all the things she'd accomplished over the years,
yeah.
It was a really interesting speech. And I was like, I turned to my dad and I said, well, this bat mitzvah thing is completely different when they're adults, because that was a really good speech. That was really interesting. I was pretty impressed. My dad said, well, yeah, the nice thing is your mom procrastinated like crazy and didn't turn it in until last night, so the rabbi didn't have any time to mess with it at all. So that's actually her speech. And I was like, oh, cool. And then the next woman got up, and she said, like, now the Bible teaches us that, and I was like, oh, now we're back to that other shit again.
Oh, yes.
You know, and then all the rest of the speeches were written by, like, 8-year-olds or the rabbi or whatever it was,
right.
And they were terrible. And
Jews love speeches.
Yeah, I know, but they got to get some better writers. Jews are great speech writers, but I don't think we're hiring them for Temple.
No.
They all go into politics or Hollywood.
Yeah.
Hollywood, politics.
Is there any hint or mention of Judaism in any of your songs?
I don't know. I mean, I'd have to look back. There's definitely stuff about religion, because I felt very much an apostate at points in my life, which was a painful thing for me, and it was definitely an issue. Jesus has cropped up a few times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm not Christian at all, but I mean, it's an example of an attachment to something like that that more people probably relate to. So it has cropped up in my songs. I don't know about the Jewish thing.
Well, he is Jewish, so.
Yes, he was a nice Jewish kid.
There
really.
You go. Started his own business.
He did. And got what we get.
I think we're going to take some questions. Is that cool?
Yeah, yeah.
From people that are here.
Hey, Adam. So we had a close encounter in 97 when you were touring with the Wallflowers, Homedale, New Jersey. And I took my son Zach for his first concert. He was like 5 years old. We got down to the stage. It was like the last song. And you were walking off, and you kind of just looked back, and you saw him. And you walked back, and you sat down next to him, and you guys talked for a couple of minutes. Wow. And it was really cool, and he was just in awe of you. And
how old was he?
He was about five.
Oh, man.
Yeah. And
I'm good with pets, moms, and kids.
And you said, so you're going to be a rock star? And he said, yes. And now he has a band called the Shady Street Show Band in Asbury Park. They're touring.
Oh.
And I really believe, honestly, that that was kind of like a moment for him.
Nice.
Mm. And he always told everybody, yeah, my friend Adam. And I want to thank you for that, because that was just so cool of you to do, to take the time, because you're probably exhausted after the show, and it was just really cool that you did that, because, you know, it's fun probably to hear the stories, how you touch people, and you probably didn't even know it, so it was really cool that you did that.
I get really uncomfortable with people, like in the crowd, and all the things people want.
Yeah.
At shows or anywhere else, just... Because I get it. It's the only time in their life. But there are 50 people in line behind them, too. You know what I mean?
Right,
so
right.
It can be a weird thing. But kids, you know, you got to take your time for a kid. You know,
You're like Mean Joe Green. Remember the commercial?
Yeah. With the
Thanks,
Coke.
Mean Joe.
Have a Diet Coke, kid.
And some heroin. This will make you a rock star.
And what's the name of the band? You said, what's this band?
Park,
oh, Shady Street Show. I really thought you said
Shitty.
Street.
That's
Show.
What I thought.
I was like, it's a choice. It's a great name.
I'm glad we clarified.
Nice.
Hey, Adam. So first of all, I'm from El Paso, Texas. Also, I spent a couple of formative years, and I remember specifically listening to Hanging Around in El Paso, thinking, I need to get out of this town. So that was like a bit of the soundtrack of my, you know, middle school days. But I had a question just in general about your songwriting style, and a lot of them seem to be these like kind of narratives and in first person, and I was just curious, do you write them from your own experiences? Like where do these stories come from?
They're all about how I feel. I'm not necessarily about what I did, but they're all about how I feel. They used to be a little more autobiographical. It was a real, the combination a few years ago of doing the covers album and singing in the voices of, you know, really experiencing how a lot of other people express themselves, and the experience of working on the play, which was the first time in my life I'd ever written for voices other than my own, and I've never written for a woman before. Those things kind of convinced me that you don't have to write stories in the eye, you know, in the first person, that are, you know, and you can still talk about all the things you want to feel. And like, my favorite song I've ever written is Palisades Park, and it's about two kids that aren't me. It has a lot of my life in it.
But a song like Hard Candy with like a trip out to Long Island and all.
Yeah, that's a true story. That's about a show at Jones Beach with the girl. You know, that's absolutely. But I mean, even that, the least interesting part of it is the part that it's the true part, that I was there. Because who cares? I mean, everybody can just write a diary. Writing a song, that's what's hard. You know, like, it's not so important whether you actually did something, but whatever you say is funny.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's the thing, is can you put yourself into it in a way that changes the bare fact of it just happening? Because the bare fact of something happening isn't necessarily all that interesting most of the time in most of our lives. Occasionally we do things that are, you know, really interesting, but most of the time it's just about living your life. Now, can you look at it in a way and express it in a way that reveals something about you? That's the joint, you know, to me. So that's what I'm always trying to do. Mm-hmm. It's just find a way inside a song to say something I want to say. But I care a lot. I used to feel like I really needed to do that and talk about my life. And now I don't really feel that way anymore.
Cool, thanks. By the way, I know Amy from that album.
I recognize the song. Like, they're not
Amy Noel?
Yeah. No, from your Underwater Sunshine album. Like, there were songs with Amy was on that album.
Oh, that, yeah, the song by Pure Prairie League?
Yeah.
You know that person?
No, I know the
person. Oh, okay.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah,
okay. Sorry.
Hello, good afternoon. This is really cool that you're here and I'm here.
Oh, you're welcome. I come here all the time.
what's your perfect day? What is like the that's ideal day for you? That's my question.
Great question.
I don't know.
Stumped.
I don't know. Yesterday, I did a bunch of work on the podcast that was pretty important. I worked on writing, which I hadn't been doing for a while, and I came up with a piece of an actual, really original piece of music, I think. You know, like, not just it sounds like other stuff I've done, but a really original piece that the first thing I've been really excited about in a long time. Like, really excited. I thought it was really completely unique. My girlfriend and I cooked dinner. I taught her how to cook some stuff.
Mansplaining.
Yeah. Well, she's not a cook. I am. No. But yeah, it's the only time when I don't get hammered with that one.
Okay.
But I'm dissociative. So a lot of times life can be at a distance. And that's I've come to expect that. That's not the easiest thing, but I can live with that. But it's nice on a day where you actually like... don't just sit there, where you do things, where like I accomplish things that I haven't done before and get a lot done. Of course, I seem to have food poisoning today, so it's it colors the cooking a little differently. But have you ever tried those like shirataki noodles? You know what they are?
No.
It's like this noodle that's made of from konjac plant, and it.
That's what you had last night?
Well, it's like a pasta that. Yeah, it's really gross at first when you open it up. It smells like fish, but you boil it and it's fine. But it's like a protein fiber thing that has no calories in it.
Okay.
So it's a way to have pasta and noodles because I've been on a diet lately, and I've been really like watching that. So we made a bunch of it. What we made is a pad see ew, you know, a Thai dish. It's like it's not the easiest thing to make. We made pad see ew last night, but I used those noodles to make it, thinking that was a. But then I read about it this morning. It says if you haven't eaten them much, you shouldn't eat a lot of them at first because they're so high fiber, your body has trouble digesting them at first. They're really, really good for you, but they might make you feel kind of sick. And I've had basically food poisoning all day. So
yeah, that's so, what did it.
Yeah, I think it is that's too. Because I don't, you know, that shit was all cooked. I don't. It was delicious.
Right. How much of it did you eat?
Not a ton, because you know, but. I guess too much. You never know what's enough until you know what's more than enough.
Any other questions?
Scared you off the question thing.
Right? All right. I'll ask one. First of all, thank you so much for being here. Like, this is amazing. Thanks for sharing your time. Sorry to go from delicious pad see ew to something more serious. But what you said about religion and your journey with religion really resonated with me. And I am possibly the only other non-Jewish person alongside Sherrod.
Speak for yourself.
But what you said really resonated with me. I was raised Christian and Catholic, and that idea of just... we're listening to these old guys and just blindly believing them resonates obviously in Catholicism too. So I find it really interesting that as an adult, you're still kind of questioning with that and you're still on this journey. So how do you reconcile, I guess, your questioning with your culture? What is your goal for you, I guess, spiritually or religiously?
I don't really have one. Yeah. I'm not sure I believe in any of that stuff. Yeah. I'm not sure there's a reason to believe in it. There's a lot of, especially in Judaism, there's a lot of things to like about why the mitzvot are there, what they're supposed to teach us. The morality is not quite as far up its ass as other religions are at times. That said, it has a fairly blinkered view of women, as all religions do pretty much, which gives me a bit of a hint that they're not necessarily divinely written. Mm. You know, because there seems to be a tilt, yeah. I don't know. I don't really, you know, someone once said to me, yeah, I'm good with it all the way up until the invisible people. Like, when you have to start believing in invisible people, I'll take Spider-Man any day. The lessons are just as good.
Yeah.
You know, and I like Peter Parker more.
Great power comes with great responsibility.
Yeah, you know, it's a pretty good way to live, you know. I think there's a lot of places to get lessons from in life. And we could take a lot of it from a lot of different places and a lot of different people who said wise things. Trying to decide that one person or one... It's why I never liked philosophy in school, because they'd get an idea, however potentially good it might be, and insist that it applied to everything. And I find that problematic. There's a lot of good lessons to learn from a lot of people, and we could probably, I feel like we have the capacity as humans to make those decisions for ourselves, and it's when we abdicate that responsibility that we get into trouble. When we start doing things that are obviously wrong because someone told us they're right and not making decisions for ourselves, I think that's a mistake. And it will lead you to a lot of, you will excuse the worst shit. History, at least, has shown that people, for a variety of reasons, one of which is religion, have done a lot of terrible, terrible shit in the name of something someone said was right and not figuring it out for themselves. It doesn't seem like a good way to live to me. But I do like the bagels. But, I mean, let's face it, too. Jewish cuisine is not the be-all, end-all. You know, like, I mean, it's good until you have French or Italian or every other cuisine on earth, you know. I mean, I love bagels. I love chicken noodle soup, and my grandmother made them really well, and I can make one of them.
What about a nice borscht?
I've tried borscht. There's a great like Ukrainian place or Polish place right around the corner from me, Veselka.
Yeah.
But and strangely enough, because they chased us on horseback, their chicken noodle soup is fantastic. But the borscht, I don't know.
No.
I didn't like it as much.
Okay.
The pierogies, those are pretty good. Or pierogies, whatever the fuck you pronounce them. Varenki.
They chased you on horseback.
Yeah, the Jews. That's what that was like the national sport in Poland, Ukraine, Russia. They had horses and they, you know, Cossacks and shit.
Okay.
So, Jew baiting. It's like, it's how they didn't have football then, so they had Jews.
Okay. That's good to know.
Any other last question? Anyone? Anyone? Nobody.
The answer was no, anyways.
But we want to thank you for your time. Really appreciate you coming up here. And everyone should listen to your podcast. What day did you release it?
We released it Wednesdays.
Wednesdays. Today. Okay.
What's the name of it?
Underwater Sunshine.
That's right, Underwater Sunshine.
Same as the music festival.
That's
and
right.
And the festival is April 5th and 6th, so come down to Bowery Electric. Come hang out with us.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, it's a blast. Would it kill you to throw a little comedy on that festival? Just a little dash?
You know, we actually talked about it this year, about doing that, because I have a lot of friends who are comedians, you know, and I thought it would be really fun to do that. It's a question of how to, like, do it. We need a third stage for it, but I think it's a really good idea. I actually like... I have a lot of friends who do comedy, so I really love comedy. And I grew up, in San Francisco in the 70s and 80s was a big comedy city.
Oh, yeah.
You know, bands used to have comedians open for them. It was really, it was what was done, you know, and vice versa.
Yeah.
It's Patti LaBelle opening for Richard Pryor on the movie, you know. Mm-hmm. That shit was really cool.
Cool. Thanks, Adam.
Thank you, guys.
Shroud, thanks.
Thank you. Yay! Yeah! Excellent. Oh, yeah, I'll take a pic.
Took the cannonball down to the ocean. Crossed the desert from cold.